Hey guys, it's Saga. In this video, let's put my personal editing machine, which is this maxed out 16-inch MacBook Pro, up against the base variant of the M1 MacBook Air and see which one does better when I put them through my workflow. I got this off-the-shelf maxed out MacBook Pro for little less than 2.5 lakh rupees and the base variant M1 MacBook Air for a little shy of 1 lakh rupees. Since I had both these laptops, I really wanted to see if the enormous price difference between the two really made sense. If you look at some of the benchmark scores, M1 MacBook Air is absolutely crushing the 16-inch MacBook Pro in single-core scores and is almost on the same level with its multi-core scores. Benchmarks don't really tell us the complete story, so I decided to test it out for myself. Now this is the base variant MacBook Air with 8-core M1 processor and just 8GB of unified RAM and 256GB of built-in storage. The MacBook Pro on the other hand packs in an 8-core i9 processor, dedicated Radeon Pro 5500M graphics processor, 16GB of RAM and 1TB of internal SSD. Now this is not a full-on review or in-depth comparison between these two laptops. I will leave that to other experts. With this video, I just wanted to check out how both of them performed for the apps that I use for my workflow and more importantly, whether the MacBook Pro can justify its higher price for my work case scenarios. When we put them head-to-head, for almost all of the day-to-day optimized apps, M1 MacBook Air is faster at opening them. This should be no surprise because these apps are optimized for this new Apple Silicon. Everything from opening apps like Safari, Chrome, Final Cut Pro, and navigating through them is faster on the M1 MacBook Air. Most of what I do is create and edit videos, so I wanted to check out this Mac's video editing performance. Now, some of you might know that I have shifted to the new Sony A7 S3 as my main computer, and the 16-inch MacBook Pro has a tough time keeping up with the footage from that camera. But the M1 MacBook Air cuts through this footage like butter. So the overall video editing experience is much more smoother on the new MacBook Air. Well, I had to adapt or change my workflow a bit to suit this laptop. Now back when I first started editing videos, I was doing that on the 2015 13-inch MacBook Pro. And when I started editing 4K videos, I needed to optimize my media on import because that made editing a bit smoother for me. I've since moved on to faster Macs, but I never changed my workflow. So when I first started editing videos with this machine, the import times were just too long. So to see what is going on, I talked with some of the other guys who are using M1 Macs, like Sandeep from RevAtlas and Harsh from Technolo, and after talking to them, I found that I can skip the optimized media part. And once I did that, my editing and exporting time have improved a lot. Now I have the same 11 minute 53 second 4K 30fps project open in Final Cut Pro on both 16-inch MacBook Pro and the M1 MacBook Air. Now this is not a test timeline. This is how my actual project looks like. It's a 4K timeline. In some places, there are multiple 4K files stacked on top of each other. There is some color correction and grading applied, and a lot of text layers stacked on top of each other. With the Sony A7 S3 footage, playback or scrubbing on the M1 MacBook Air is much smoother than it is on the 16-inch MacBook Pro. 30fps footage is fine, but if there is 60 or 120fps footage on the timeline, this is when my MacBook Pro really struggles. I've left background rendering on both these laptops because that is how I normally edit my videos and I wanted to see which one is faster for my everyday workflow. Now in this first test, I'm exporting this 4K 30fps project to H.264 and the 16-inch MacBook Pro exported it first in 8 minutes and 50 seconds and the M1 MacBook Air followed it in 9 minutes and 39 seconds. So the 8-core i9 MacBook Pro with a dedicated GPU and 16GB of RAM was just under 50 seconds faster than the base variant of the first generation M1 MacBook Air. And not to mention that the M1 MacBook Air has no fans to keep it cool, whereas the fans on the MacBook Pro were spinning at pretty much full throttle right from the beginning of the export. I cleared cache files and tried this export multiple times and found similar results from both. Now for the second test, when I exported this file in ProRes instead of H.264, the MacBook Pro was able to export it in just 5 minutes and 15 seconds and the Air did it in 5 minutes and 54 seconds, so just 39 seconds behind the 16-inch MacBook Pro. To be honest, I was shocked with the results. There is no doubt that the MacBook Pro is still faster and finished first, but the margin was not that big. And not to mention that this is pretty much maxed out MacBook Pro, whereas the MacBook Air is running on the base variant specs. Pro also gets really hot while editing, and it has fans running most of the time. And its battery has never lasted me for more than 2.5 or 3 hours while editing. MacBook Air on the other hand gets a little warm, but it is still comfortable enough to place it on your lap. It doesn't have fans, so it is quiet all the time, and I was able to complete this edit on its battery and it still had 23% remaining. Given the price of these two laptops, I would any day take a few extra seconds to export a video if it is helping me save almost 1.5 lakh rupees. Video editing, watching some YouTube videos, scripting, researching for new videos, and some light photo editing is all I do on my laptop, and this MacBook Air is serving me very well for all those tasks. Now, everyone might have different workflows and might use different apps than the ones that I use. So I can't say whether or not the M1 MacBook Air would suit their workflow and perform just as good for them. But for my video editing workflow, this has been a wonderful machine. After having used the 27-inch iMac and 16-inch MacBook Pro, this 13-inch display definitely feels small to me. But I can just as easily buy an external display with the money that I get after I sell my 16-inch MacBook Pro. Something else that I miss coming to this laptop is the extra USB-C ports. Now, I don't always use more than 2 USB-C ports at a time. Actually, I don't ever remember using more than 2 USB-C ports on my 16-inch MacBook Pro. But what I miss is their placement. I don't mind having just 2 USB-C ports, but I would have loved to have them on either side of the laptop. Right now, both the ports on this laptop are on the left side, so it is a bit inconvenient if I had to use both of them at the same time. I got this MacBook Air for my wife, so we went with the base variant because 256GB of storage and 8GB of RAM is plenty for her work for years to come. But if I would have been getting it for myself, I would definitely go with 16GB of RAM and 512GB of SSD. For any more storage, I would get a fast external drive like Samsung T7. So there you have it, my thoughts about both these laptops. I can't wait for the next generation Apple Silicon iMac to come here, because whenever it arrives, it is going to be my new editing machine, and I'm really excited about it. So am I getting rid of this 16-inch MacBook Pro? Probably yes. And until the next iMac arrives, I might just keep on using this MacBook Air for editing all my videos. That means my wife will have to keep on using her 2015 13-inch MacBook Pro for a little longer. I hope she doesn't mind. Well, that is it for this video, guys. Please hit the like button if you enjoyed this video and subscribe to the channel for more quality tech videos like this. You can also check out some of the other videos from this channel. This has been Sagar, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Take care.